Welcome everybody to another episode of Beyond the Patterns. Today we have a really exciting guest. It's going to be Niels Thure from TU Munich, and he is working on differentiable physical simulation. So I'll tell you, there's exciting things coming up today. You'll see plenty of videos and how to integrate a physical solver differentiably into a deep neural network. Exciting work. Niels Thure is an associate professor at the Technical University of Munich. He focuses, of course, on deep learning methods for physical systems with an emphasis on fluid flow problems. Beyond latent space simulation algorithms and generative models, he is currently especially interested in learning algorithms powered by differentiable solvers. So today's presentation will therefore also be entitled Differentiable Physics Simulations for Deep Learning. Niels, it's a great pleasure to have you here, and the stage is yours.
For the introduction, Andreas. It's great to be virtually in Erlangen, at least. I studied in Erlangen and did my PhD, so I have a lot of good memories, and I hope to be back in person at some point. But yeah, this is also nonetheless a very good opportunity. I want to talk about some of the works that we're busy with in my group, and not surprisingly, which I think are a very interesting direction at the moment for research. And as you can see from the title, that is coupling differentiable physics simulations with deep learning algorithms. Yeah, let me start very broadly. Why are we interested in this? We're typically looking at physical phenomena that are everywhere around us in our everyday lives. So the air around you in the room you're in, that's going into your lungs, you typically don't see it. But if you have something like smoke, you see that typically there are very complicated motions beneath it. It's very important for classical questions such as, right, how much lift do we need to keep an airplane up in the air? And interestingly, also actually for the glass of water on your desk, it obeys very similar descriptions. Typically for liquids, we are in the air, we're looking at the liquid, so it's a two-phase problem. We're looking at the interface, but nonetheless, the equations are, the underlying physical models are very similar. In robotics, just to give one additional area, there are also all kinds of interesting problems. This robotic fish is a very good example, but right, all kinds of robots in practice have to interact with the flow, be it around an autonomous vehicle or some autonomous creatures in the water. The point being, there are all kinds of applications here. Although fluids might sound a bit specialized at first, it's really a very broad topic, from chemical reactions over plasma physics, energy topics to medical ones. It comes up a lot. And the underlying physical model, which I have to show here, this is really the basis of everything I'll be dealing with in the following, are the Navier-Stokes equations. I don't want to go into any additional detail here. It's just that, right, we have classical equations here. They're very established, and we can approximate them in the computer. So in a way, now the interesting questions at the moment is, given all these exciting new deep learning algorithms, how do these go into the picture here? And I want to take a fairly pragmatic standpoint here. So these physical models, they're great. We want to keep them. And also we have, over the course of many decades here, very powerful numerical methods to find approximations to these, right, idealized continuous descriptions. And these are also, I think, very powerful. So now the question is, what does the machine learning in general, or specifically deep learning as the most powerful instance at the moment, give us here? And one very important goal, which I think is justifying all this effort, is that it allows us to bridge or make the step from these idealized descriptions towards more real-world scenarios and might learn errors or remaining uncertainties in the data. And admittedly, that still has plenty of work left to do, but I want to focus on this direction in my talk and at least hopefully give you a few pointers to what in the next years will be realized with that. Yeah, so that's a general goal of my talk. And if we just look at this intersection of simulations and deep learning, it's good to point out a bit more specifically where these combinations fit in or what they look like. For numerical simulations, we can very roughly distinguish two types of problems that we're dealing with. One is the classical forward simulation. We're starting out with boundary conditions, an initial setup, and then we get an evolution, say, over time of a fluid or of some system we're interested in. In many practical scenarios, however, we are actually often interested in inverse problems, meaning we'd like to know how can we build an airfoil such that it gives us the best lift given a certain amount of material. And for all these cases, we typically have some kind of outer optimization loop. So the problems involve physics and steps like the forward simulation, but are orders of magnitude more expensive to find these kind of derived or to solve these derived questions on top of the simulations. And now within these classical forward and inverse problems, we can combine them with deep learning. And I think it's good to distinguish with respect to how tightly the learning is integrated. So what you could call classical supervised approaches essentially are outside of this simulation system, mostly dealing with the data. There's a variety of methods that now try to use parts of the physical formulation kind of as soft constraints, as loss terms. But what I want to aim for in the following is to really very tightly interleave the full simulation process with the learning. So I want to focus on this last block, what you could summarize as interleaved or in the title, what was meant with these differentiable simulations. So I'll come back to the details there in the following. Also, admittedly, that's we're really not the only ones working on this. There's a variety of interesting papers. Here's just a very small selection. And I'll be focusing on two works from my group. I know those best and I can best explain those, namely the first paper here from Philip, seen below, and the solver in the loop paper from Kiwon and collaborators. So this will be the focus in the following. So I also directly want to explain in a bit more detail what is meant with this differentiable physics. It's definitely a kind of moniker to denote methods that could be called otherwise, but I think it's a fairly good name in line with differentiable rendering and programming. What I mean with that in the following is we have some differential equation P that describes some prior knowledge that we know about the system we're interested in. We have some states S of the system. This could be like positions and velocities or some volumetric sampling of velocities. And for a differentiable solver now, what we're interested in is one that gives us a gradient dp ds. So given some output of our simulator and ideally a change of that output, we'd like to know how do we need to change an input to P to our simulator such that we get this change in S? And right, especially if you're a bit into the field, this is not so special for all deep learning applications. We have this, but for simulators, actually not always given that this is available out of the box. But I hope that for all future generations, we'll be able to obtain these gradients because they actually do play a very important role, as I want to show in the following. Yeah, so potentially that's not given for all simulators, especially not ancient codes, but this is a bit what I want to argue for. This is very useful to have. And a question that often comes up here, there are these physics-informed approaches, PINs. This is not what I'll be talking about. These actually just put part of the physics into an additional constraint in the loss. I want to argue for using a full, carefully constructed, ideally accurate simulator in the learning process, with the goal of tightly integrating the learning and the simulation. Yeah, so with that, I directly want to come to the first example, because I think it will show that process very nicely. And the setup we're looking at here is learning numerical errors. So imagine you have this PDE description P, and we have some nice fine discretization shown with this blue blob here on the left-hand side. So this is our solution manifold, can imagine. And now if we, for example, have one evolution of a system over time, that could be the trajectory shown in blue here, starting from T0 up to some final time Tn. And now if we take, this is the reference, if we take the same description and discretize it coarsely or with some simpler, more approximate, maybe faster methods, indicated here by this rougher sampling of this blob, we typically get very different answers. Even if we start at kind of the same point, T0, projected into this coarser space, you can still see for reference this blue curve on the right-hand side. But if we now fully resimulate the same trajectory in this coarse space, we get something like the orange curve here. And the whole point, what this should illustrate, is that it most likely will not follow the blue curve, but we will accumulate discretization errors. These will add up over time and give us a different answer. And the gap between this approximation and the blue curve is now some numerical error that has been made potentially by a fairly complicated solver over a large number of steps. So for all practical cases, we actually do not have any closed form answer of what this error looks like. We can, in a way, measure it from these two setups, from a fine simulation, potentially expensive, and this coarse one. But this is exactly now where we'd like to, or where I think it's a very interesting challenge to use learning, going from this approximation closer towards the accurate reference answer that we'd like to have. And yeah, one of the really interesting points here is, right, this is a function. This difference is something we cannot just write down, but as I'll show later on, we can actually learn large parts of it from such a tandem approach. And right, in the following, I'll actually denote this neural network that should move us closer to this reference by C or for a corrector, typically given some state of our system S and is conditioned on some set of weights theta. Yeah, so before going into this interleaved and tighter coupling, I want to show or illustrate again what the simpler supervised approach would look like here. Classically, for machine learning, you could now go ahead and say we have these solvers for this reference space and the orange one, this approximation. We can pre-compute a lot of data there for both. We can set them up with similar initial conditions. Then we have pairs and train this in a supervised fashion. So in a way, this is a very simple and classic setup. So we invoke our network to basically produce this difference between the two states, for example, with an L2 loss as written here. So state plus this correction should be, or minus the reference state should amount to zero. And then as always with deep learning, with all given frameworks, we can compute a gradient for the weights and repeat this process in many iterations until our network has learned this residual. So with a solver, we can also produce a large number of reliable data. So in a way, this seems like on first sight, might seem like a very good approach. But one big takeaway here is just visually, the solver only plays a role in the data generation. The process at the bottom fully deals with the network. And as you can imagine, maybe this is actually not necessarily the ideal approach. So also to illustrate what these physics-informed variants would do, in these cases, you would approximate the solution with a network and then formulate a part of the physical residual of P with the network. Again, compute a loss, reduce these residuals, and backpropagate through the derivatives of the network in addition to some direct loss for data points. A nice thing here is that we can compute some derivatives from the network. However, there's no explicit discretization here. The discretization is happening in the network and it's a bit out of the control. And more importantly, again, just for now visually, right, this solver, the green arrow is not in this picture at all. We're not using any real simulation in this case. We're kind of reformulating our model P with these residuals, but in a way, it's a very different thing from a proper simulation approach. Yeah, so if we now have such a solver that is differentiable, where we have the derivative with respect to S, one thing that we can typically do quite nicely is leverage similar numerical methods that we would use for the forward solve. And typically, we have quite a nice a toolbox of reliable numerical methods here. There's typically a bit of a choice how on which scale we want to compute these gradients. If you know how these processes work, naively you could go ahead and basically say, well, in any deep learning framework, we by now have vector operations. We can do matrix multiplications. We can add, subtract vectors. So we can formulate a full solver. I could directly write a solver for P in any deep learning framework and then backpropagate through it for free. But typically this gives me an extremely slow and inefficient process, because these frameworks are storing a lot of intermediate information across every single operation. So instead, it's actually a good idea to put in some knowledge for solving P and construct gradients using that knowledge. So one specific good example is Poisson solves happen a lot. So we have some Laplacian matrix here denoted by A, for example, and we need to multiply some right-hand side that's given with the inverse of that. That's a step that happens in image editing up to many physical simulations a lot. If we're now interested in the derivative with respect to the right-hand side, interestingly, it's the same matrix as shown here on the right. The A inverse is the same that we would normally apply to the right-hand side itself. And hence, the derivative here with respect to the right-hand side B is actually just the matrix, meaning if we have a good solver in the forward case to multiply with that inverse, we can use the same to compute the gradient efficiently in a backwards pass. And this will typically, if we use a good solver, work much better than just writing the solver itself in TensorFlow or so. So right at this point, we can actually, if we think about it a bit, do much better than naively applying a deep learning framework. Yeah. And then once we have this on a kind of right granularity, the combination of all these components with autodiff, that happens as before in deep learning. Now, one other part that I've not mentioned too much for now, but that turns out to be really important is these, or I would argue any numerical solver is typically iterative. We typically have some iteration process, be it explicitly over time, implicitly, or internally for an implicit solver, and basically repeated applications of some potentially complicated steps. And in the setting I'm describing here, this neural network C now needs to interact over the whole course of these iterated steps. And hence, we're not just interested in how the error evolves for a single step, but over the whole time span, potentially many steps here just shown with this N. So we're interested in a whole chain of many steps that are influenced by a neural network corrector or generally some interaction with the neural network. And can actually write it out, really unrolling the time loop in the loss here. It looks a bit unwieldy, but essentially the most important thing to keep in mind is that we want to minimize these errors, not just for single pairs at one given time step, but across a whole chain of evaluations. And once I've applied the network once to any state in my system, actually I have a recursion. The states will not be the ones I can pre-compute, but states modified by a network. Those get put into a solver again, will be modified again. So here in this notation, it's indicated by this tilde over the S. So the important point here being, I will later on have different states that are modified by the network that are unlike those that I would get out of a normal simulation. And you can imagine if any network should work in the setting, it actually needs to see those states at training time, ideally. But they're not something I can pre-compute because I will only have them once I have a network to change the states with. So it's a bit of a chicken and egg problem, but this is exactly what we can deal with these differentiable physics approaches. So here the idea is now, again, visually to have a network that changes the state, but this modified state then goes through a full solving process through a simulator. So this is really my ideally whole, right, carefully designed simulation system running at training time. And this is done for ideally the whole chain of n steps that I'm typically interested in, or at least something on the order of the time horizon that we're looking at. And now I can start computing a loss. In the setting I've described, typically we have pairs, so we can compute the loss across these different pairs and accumulate now, you can call them adjoints or these gradients through the solver. So the important visual quantity here is really this backwards arrow, the green one. This is now the backpropagation through my whole solver, giving me how a change in S needs to be reflected in the input to the solver. And this gradient now can go into the network. This gives me first update of the theta weights. And when I do it this way, I can actually use these carefully chosen discretizations to compute this update. And this step is now repeated. I can, in this setting, accumulate additional losses and backpropagate through the whole chain of time steps. And it's definitely, as indicated here, it's not cheap. I need the whole forward simulation process. And typically on the order, or a similar order of computations for the backwards pass. And all this gives me one single update of my weights. But I typically also do it for a mini batch. It's not just one simulation, but maybe 8 or 16 or so. And this needs to happen, right, hundreds of thousands of times, or millions if for more complex networks. So it's definitely costly, but later on I will, as I'll show, actually get a state of the network that you cannot reach otherwise. So if I deploy my network a lot, if I use it a lot, hopefully this complexity pays off. Yeah, and with that I can directly come to some examples. So one really classic question, fluid flow, is I have a domain with some inflow and an obstacle in the flow. We're looking at a set of different initial conditions in terms of Reynolds numbers here, testing on some different ones. And here you can see on the right some snapshots on the bottom, this reference on the top. There's a rougher discretization, in this case by a factor of 4. And just visually, if you compare these, the vortices in red and blue that you can see at the bottom are not resolved at the top. And next, oh yeah, right. If we now compute an error, just to give some numbers about the difference with some normalized quantities here, we get a mean absolute error of 0.14 roughly here. And now if we switch to the learned version shown at the top here, visually, I hope you can already see that it's actually very difficult to make out differences between the two. And if you compute the error here, it's gone down by roughly a factor of 10 to 0.013. So this is a nice reduction in terms of error. And the important thing now here is also that this didn't happen just for individual snapshots, but it works for the whole simulation for 200 or 250 frames in this case. So the network is applied repeatedly here, and over the whole course, even starting from the same conditions, can keep the solution close to what we expect from the reference on the right. So you can see this base input on the left, in the middle there's a hybrid. This now still uses the same source that you see on the left. It's the same simulation running with an additional corrector in the form of a neural network. I didn't mention before, but for simplicity, we actually typically assume here that we can just add the correction on top. You could imagine other functions to combine it, but from our experience, actually an addition works very well in practice. And yeah, on the right, there's a case of the larger Reynolds number. Again, you can see the source deviates quickly, gives something very washed out without resolving the vortices properly. And the learned version here stays quite close to the reference. You can see in the name here, there's a 32, SOL32 for this model. So that indicates that in the training process, there were 32 steps of simulation being unrolled for every update of the neural network. And that's of course a free parameter. And we tested that out a bit. Here you can see the results for varying numbers of these steps. So let me point out a few differences here. These are all now improvements with respect to the base version. So 0 would be no improvement at all, and 1 would be perfect. So this NON version here in gray, that is the supervised training I've mentioned before. And right, the best you can actually achieve in this case by pre-computing data is around 30%. And then if you already unroll 4 steps, you get more than 10% more. And in this case, up to 128 steps of simulation actually still paid off. And in a way here, more than double the improvements or kind of closing this gap towards the reference. So in this case, we're really making up for 60% of the way towards the reference solve with respect to an L2 norm. Yeah, so in this case, it really paid off to do more and more unrolling. In a way, it's potentially just a question of computational resources. We've also tried the 3D case. In this case, interestingly, the supervised version does not stay stable at all. So here on the left, you can see this non-version for denoting the supervised case. This just produces more or less garbage, as you can see here by these oscillating artifacts. The version with the solver stays stable in this case. Here is one of these cases in motion. Again, on the left, the basis of the two methods, the source only. In the middle, we have source plus network, the right inside the reference. In 3D, we additionally have much more complex rotations, now three axes of rotation. And if you look closely, especially over time, these are, again, I think 250 frames. The solutions deviate, but in general, the combined solver here in the middle, this hybrid version, keeps a lot more of the structures that we expect from the reference, even if they're not always exactly at the right spots. Yeah, actually, when running these 3D cases and showing them in the paper on white background, we noticed that it looks a lot like a goldfish or some fish, guppy or so, smoking cigars. But right, the paper was, of course, in reality more about these flow simulations, not about fish. Another important thing to point or to discuss in this context is the performance, of course, because we're dealing with fully simulated quantities here. So we have our reference solve. This does not need to be differentiable, by the way. The reference could be a black box. We just need this source solver to be in the learning. And in this case, we have a CPU-based reference, which for this case actually took more than 900 seconds. And the approximate solve combined with the CNN, which actually ran on a GPU, taking around 13 seconds, which gives a nice speed up, more than 60. Even if you factor out roughly 10 or so for the GPU, there's a nice speed up of more than 6 left. But I think this is really just a first data point. And we could potentially see arbitrary improvements and speed ups here. If you think about future hardware, I think right now we're already seeing it with some of the Apple GPUs. And I think many cell phones actually have now dedicated neural units that evaluate neural networks. These are improving quite a bit in the past years. I expect that to continue. So if you have a trained model like this one, it's actually also now not super cheap, but I would expect this to speed up significantly without any changes. And especially also looking at more traditional, maybe older reference codes, I think we can see very large speedups as a result of this combination. Yeah, as a second variant of this problem, and I want to show some results from this other paper I mentioned in the beginning. So here we're now a bit more directly focusing on these inverse problems, the previous one being learning this error function, this unknown error that we have. And now we imagine we still have a fluid flow in something like this room. A fire breaks out, and now we want to control the exhaust valves in the ceiling or in this room to remove the smoke as quickly or to push the smoke as quickly as possible out of the next window. And this is now such an inverse problem where we're not interested in very specific states of the solution, but right, the smoke should be out of the window. This is all that we're interested in. And in a way, this problem is much more difficult because now the constraints we're imposing are less direct. And we have a kind of planning task. So in this case, it's impossible to directly remove the smoke. This happens at some later state in time. We're typically picking a fixed interval. And we just want the smoke to be out of the window after 32 steps of simulation or so. So in this case, it turned out we need two networks. One that does a prediction, essentially this planning step, what the solution ideally should look like after a certain number of steps moving towards this goal. And then we have a second network that actually acts, that activates our exhausts and influences the physical system, the fluid. And again, this tandem, we can train jointly and in a very similar fashion visually, especially for this kind of action network called CFE in this context. The main difference is that now we have one single loss at the end of this chain, and this gets back propagated all the way back to the beginning. And what's not explicitly denoted here, but this predictor now is also this control network is conditioned on the predictor, and we can train all this jointly with the simulator, working a lot better than in a supervised approach. Our simulations to show this case admittedly looked a lot simpler than the image I showed before. So now our room is this box here. Our exhaust is the light blue region, and the fire is this, or the smoke is this orange or yellow blob in the middle. And we have the three windows at the top. Now the network is trained to basically push around the fluid in these blue domains arbitrarily to move the yellow smoke that can occur anywhere out of these windows at the top. So this also worked quite nicely. The network with this differential training can work that, can learn that quite reliably. In this case, it's also quite similar to problems you would maybe address with reinforcement learning. But it's good to point out that we have 5,000 continuous control variables here. So this would be a case that would, as far as I know, be extremely difficult to tackle with a traditional reinforcement learning approach. Yeah, and this should serve as an example of the inverse problems we can solve with similar approaches here. With that, I directly want to come to a bit of a summary and an outlook for my talk. I hope I was able to illustrate a bit that these differentiable physics simulations are a very powerful tool to bridge physical simulations and learning processes. It's learning on one side and these numerical methods and our physical models on the other side. And I've talked about this correction and control tasks. I think one very interesting potential next step that is much more complex in terms of the simulation, but not very unlike the fluid cases I've shown before, is weather prediction. So there we have a lot of interacting, a lot of influences changing the weather and the behavior and the evolution of the system, and a very large scale, ideally our whole planet. But nonetheless, I think there's huge potential for learning with the data we have and with these weather prediction simulations of the forecasting systems in the loop to improve these weather predictions. So that's a very interesting potential outlook. And if we think about the setup a bit more generically, ideally, we'd like to bridge this gap between the learning and the simulation process. And there's really no reason for any borders or artificial boundaries to exist. So one of the calls I want to make here is to basically remove the borders between these systems. There's a very nice quote from Thor Heyerdahl, a Norwegian explorer, which I'll just let you read. But he, of course, meant this for the real world, where this is potentially even more important. But I think it's also a good mindset for setting up simulation systems. We really should not think of simulations and learning as being separate software packages or separate instances, but ideally they go together and exchange data and derivatives freely, which will improve both the learning process and also with this learning process, I think we have a lot of potential improving the simulations. So the goal is really to bring these two much closer together. And a topic I have barely touched on here, but ultimately, of course, the goal here is to improve our understanding of our world, of the physical systems. And that seems like or at least if you read the news, like a contradiction on first sight, applying these huge data-driven machine learning approaches. But I am very confident here that we will also make or improve our understanding from these deep learning approaches. I think there are very good pointers, say, in the Go community, where people now learn from neural networks being trained to play Go, teaching humans new strategies. I think our tools to look at what networks do will improve a lot and ultimately also allow us to maybe find improved formulations that describe physical systems. So a very interesting and tough topic, but I think a very important outlook to mention here in this context. Yeah, also all the examples, I want to close with a bit of advertising. All the examples I've shown are done with an open source solver called PhiFlow, initiated by Philip Hall, who I had on the slides earlier on, a PhD student in my group. And this is available as open source. We're just preparing version 2. I was hoping I could already tell you to download version 2. It should be coming up any day now. But this is a framework meant to provide differentiable simulations across different platforms, be it TensorFlow, PyTorch, or JAX or so, and has some very nice functionality, for example. It largely gets rid of reshaping by having dimensions that are known to be either batch dimensions or spatial dimensions. And typically, that lets you work quite intuitively with the simulation data and learning around it. So if you're interested, please try it out and feel free to let us know how that's working for you. Here's also the link if you're interested in. And yeah, with that, I also want to thank again my students and collaborators, and also the funding agencies, Intel and the European Research Council. And thanks for listening. Yeah, I'd be happy to answer questions.
Thank you very much for this presentation. Really inspiring. And although we're virtual, I have a small round of applause for you. I hope you can hear it. Unfortunately, yes, just pre-recorded, but at least it feels a little bit like you could actually interact with our audience.
Thanks. That's
really inspiring work. Absolutely fabulous. I loved your talk. Really great. And I found it interesting that essentially very similar things are going on in the image reconstruction community, where they also have inverse problems. And turns out that you can also integrate like the physical knowledge that you have about the world directly into the networks in a very, very similar approach that you do. And what we've seen there quite frequently actually is that we can also reduce the number of parameters in the networks. I mean, you can do it data-driven end-to-end and then it predicts something, but these networks typically have like a lot of parameters, like beyond millions, but we can already get very, very good approximations using the physics and slimming down on the number of unknowns. Did you see similar effects?
Yes, that is it's a very good point, right? This whole differentiable programming community and integrating all the processes around learning into the learning itself, I think is a very good direction. I can imagine that for MRI and imaging modalities, that's also a very good idea. And yes, we've also seen that early on, basically a few years ago, we also tried to purely learn these solutions, like these flows. And then you typically need huge networks that really produce the generative models that give you whole velocity fields. And for those to be flexible enough to cover a larger range of solutions, you need fairly heavy networks. The ones I've shown here for these corrections, they're actually relatively small. They're much smaller than what you would need for a generative model to directly produce the outputs that I've shown. Yeah.
And what kind of architecture do you use? By the way, you can also stop the screen sharing. Then we see more of you.
That's a good idea. Yes, a good point.
What kind of architectures do you use in the small blocks? Yeah.
We typically have fully convolutional CNNs with UNet structures or ResNets.
Excellent. Okay.
We typically work on, for now, regular grids similar to an image, and then have basically convolutional operations in certain neighborhoods. And the domains typically don't have any preference, so the solution could shift anywhere and the correction should be applicable anywhere. So typically this fully convolutional CNN is a very good approach here. That being said, in the simulation community, traditionally, we often would like to use other kinds of grids with adaptive data structures, for example, refining around some obstacle that's in the flow. But I think there's no inherent reason for why that should not work. It's more a question of data structures, putting in changing grids rather than a regular one.
Then you probably also need quite dynamic code for the constructing everything, right?
It becomes a lot more expensive then, because you need more flexible convolutions that can work as variable connectivities. It will be more costly and more difficult to set up, which is also why we focused on the simple case for now. But I think in a way, given these engineering or the right tools on that side, I think this should transfer.
Very nice. Regarding the GPUs, you mentioned the speed up due to the compute power. Do you also make use of texture units? So in reconstruction, we have quite a bit of ray casting and stuff like that. And there you also get quite a bit of speed up because you can use the textures very efficiently.
Right. We do have one other project where it's also, I think, similar to what you have in mind, where some differential rendering process, some imaging is going into the loop. And there we also make use of texture units, and the imaging is happening more on the GPU. But what I've shown, the simulations actually ran mostly on the CPU and the networks on the GPU, but this in the end are standard convolutional operations. Also the simulations typically have very similar finite difference dances or so, which are evaluated on neighborhoods. So there we did not, I think it could actually pay off to implement those very efficiently with texture units. It could pay off, but we haven't done that so far.
Yeah. It comes at a cost of implementing the specialized operators and so on. Yeah. And that's,
I think that's...
you have to be very exact with the implementation. Otherwise, it can cost a lot of time to do so. I completely agree.
But it's a good idea.
I also found that the remark very interesting about the reinforcement learning, that you could technically also do it, but a reinforcement learning approach would take much, much more time, right? Because you can't propagate through the black box that you're using for...
Right, exactly. Reinforcement learning typically treats the system as a black box, but we're getting this question quite a bit because reinforcement learning has seen these huge success stories with Go and StarCraft and so on. And then people think, oh yeah, this is so powerful, DeepMind could do it, this also should work on my physics problem. But I also think that it's much better idea to at least also combine these gradients and the knowledge we have about physics with such a learning process. And then it's arguable whether you really need reinforcement learning with some Q estimators or so.
I completely agree. This is, I found it interesting that you get this question very often.
I talk about these control problems. People think, why do we need these differential simulations? I can use the AlphaGo technology. Shouldn't that work better? But I think it still pays off to invest.
Absolutely. I'm completely on your side. Is there an upper bound on the Reynolds number for the simulations? Is that a thing?
Practically, through what we can resolve with a given discretization. So also on the, I don't have the full data set here, but this course, the source solver, as we call it, this rough approximation already had a lot of difficulties capturing anything from the larger Reynolds numbers we were targeting. Because it's very diffusive, it basically adds a lot of error to the solution. And effectively, this numerical diffusion limits the Reynolds number you can practically achieve. And again, also on the reference side, for the targets, we have through the resolution some upper bound, at which point it would probably be relatively meaningless to try and target even higher ones. By replacing that with a better solver, I think theoretically you could aim for any larger one, but also then the gap between the source and the reference space becomes more larger. Something I haven't touched on much, but in practice, the closer they are, the easier this difference is to learn. And the further they are apart, the less useful this this input solver will be. At some point, you more or less have to learn the whole function. And then you're more or less back to a generative model again, and it might become very difficult. So the assumption here is still that this source solver gives you some estimate, that it goes a bit in the right direction, but does not capture everything. And then the last step we're making with a learned approach, but if the source solver does not help, or right, worst case, just diffuses things and goes in the wrong direction, then we might as well just try to learn the data itself. And this is very application specific, so it's difficult to quantify. I say, right, this is always the best mixture.
So if I think that your method should also have quite a few advantages in terms of generalization. So if you now go to different simulation setups in like dynamically changing boundary conditions, or moving the cylinder in the 3D Wakeflow example, how well does you generalize in these cases?
That's also a very good point. We didn't try moving the obstacle, but having the simulator in the loop, and the simulator basically also learns from the errors the correction makes itself. You can imagine, especially in the beginning, the corrector goes off and produces all kinds of weird solutions that go in different directions. So in practice, the generalization is definitely better. It's also difficult to quantify. And I think it's definitely much better than with a supervised approach. However, even in these cases, we found that it makes a lot of sense to try and cover the whole space that you want to use the method for later on. Ideally, in the split, if we can change the conditions of the solver to produce something new, that will work quite well. But if, say, we now use a 10 times larger velocity in the source solver that the network has never seen, then most likely it will not work that well. Mm-hmm. So it's still typically good to try and cover the space as thoroughly as possible at training time, at least locally. So what, for example, would work quite nicely in these cases is enlarging the domain or changing other parameters. There it transfers quite well. But the typical range of values that the network sees, that should at least be covered at training time.
Yeah, so we did some experiments in imaging, setting up a special rebinning problem. And there we could actually show that we can train only with simulated cylinders and spheres and a bit of noise. And the learned algorithm could be transferred to anthropomorphic phantoms and also work with them. But we had really a lot of priors embedded in the knowledge, and it was only a couple of thousand parameters that we're actually learning. But if you have this very strong constraint, a lot of physical knowledge, then the generalization properties were also very good. Then again, you lose the advantage of the like large step sizes and so on that you can do with the approach that you're suggesting. So what I really like about what you're showing is that you kind of dose it, and you can go essentially from one extreme to the other extreme in a continuous fashion. So depending on your application, you can just design it in a way that makes sense for that particular problem.
Right. In the synthetic session, set up, there is some freedom to choose it such that it still works well, right?
Yeah.
What ultimately would also in this setting be interesting, of course, is instead of this reference data to have actual observations, measurements from an experiment or so. And then we'd have very few of those, and the gap or the target would be given. And then we'd probably need to move the source setup close enough so that we can learn it, and probably also pre-train on simulated data, because this would be a pretty large gap. But I think ultimately that would be the goal, to have, instead of a reference, to have observations or measurements.
But it's fantastic to see that all of what you're showing is essentially compatible with everything that you see in deep learning. So you can just click them together in a kind of plug and play way, right?
Right. Once you have the setup with the differentiable process, exactly, you can mix and match in any way you like. And like in other communities, I think that's a very good way to go to seamlessly integrate it and have applications that work well with learning.
Absolutely. Right. Would this approach also work well with solid mechanics? Did you solve any such examples?
We haven't looked at that much. So for solids, typically Lagrangian discretizations, so basically discretizations that move with a body, with a cup or so, are more popular. For fluids, we typically have a Eulerian one. We have a fixed grid and things are moving in the grid. But right, if I want to deform some object, then typically we center the discretization around the object. And then I think in general, it will be a very good idea to also incorporate the solver and have, right, stress evaluations or physical properties being simulated on that discretization into the learning. So I think on that level, it's definitely a good idea, but I think the network structures would look quite different. We've looked at it a bit for liquids with particle-based discretizations. We basically use some more continuous convolutions that look at particle neighborhoods. And right, that is definitely also a good way to go. And I can imagine for solids that some more graph-based, some graph network structures might be a good idea to basically set up the discretization of some object.
Really cool. There's one final question. And the question is, it's a mean one. What are the limitations of your work?
Okay. That's a good question, right? The complexity that we have looked at, we've basically shown, I think, a nice set of examples. But going beyond that, I think will become more difficult. So maybe one specific one that I can mention in the context here is for the first approach, learning the errors. One limitation that we are still investigating was that this look ahead over time that I mentioned does not necessarily always pay off. For the 3D case, especially, we had in the end around 16 paid off, but then larger ones did essentially not change the level of error that we could reduce. My guess is it's also related to resources and training time and network sizes, but I think that's an open question how to scale that up. And maybe another limitation in general is I think there are a lot of open questions. So these are just first steps, but it's it's very open how to really move forward. And ideally, the long-term goal would be to tightly integrate all these learned methods into classical simulators. And for that, I think there's still a long time to go, and also a lot of trust to build on the user side. I think right now, many people, especially in many classical disciplines like fluid mechanics and simulation communities, are still very skeptical about these approximate learning methods. That being said, also, numerical methods initially had a very bad reputation, right? For mathematicians were used to solving things analytically. All these numerical approximations initially seemed very bad, but then we actually made processes and were able to analyze and come up with reasonable thresholds. And all this is now missing on the learning side. So I think there's a lot of work left to be done. But I think it's not impossible to do it, but this is definitely missing. This is also a clear limitation for all these methods at the moment.
Niels, there may be skeptics, but I'm completely convinced what you've shown today. Thank you very much. This was a wonderful presentation, and I'm very glad that you accepted our invitation. So have another round
of applause. Thanks for joining, everyone.
Yeah, you can see we had plenty of questions for his presentation, and obviously I really enjoyed this talk. So if you do have any questions, the discussion isn't over yet, so you can reach us either by letting some comments here and we will try to answer them. We will be in contact with Niels, so that's no big problem. Or on the other side, you could also follow us on social media and send your comments there. So Niels and I, we're both on Twitter, so you can also contact us very easily. So I hope you enjoyed this video as well, and I'm very much looking forward to seeing you again in one of the next episodes of Beyond the Patterns.